Good morning to all the participants in the world. On behalf of Department of Civil Engineering of KLS Shri Vasantra Poddar Polytechnic Belagavi, in association with All About Structural Analysis and Design, welcome you all for International Webinar Series in Civil Engineering, which has been approved and sponsored by ISTE, Indian Society for Technical Education. Our co-sponsors are Bharti Cement, Bangur Cement and Wicat France. I, Mrs. Swati Joshi, lecturer from Civil Department, KLS Shri Vasantra Poddar Polytechnic Belagavi, welcome all the participants and the resource person, Professor Lakshmi Angdi. KLS Shri Vasantra Poddar Polytechnic Belagavi was started in the year 1992, formerly known as Polytechnic for Women. Later, in the year 2000, it was renamed as KLS Shri Vasantra Poddar Polytechnic Belagavi with co-education. Currently, Vasantra Poddar Polytechnic is offering diploma education in 5 disciplines, that is Architecture, Civil Engineering, Computer Science Engineering, Electronics and Communication Engineering, and Mechanical Engineering. The webinar series is hosted by All About Structural Analysis and Design, a YouTube channel. A new online platform for learning civil engineering, which has been started in the year 2019 by Professor Abhijit Baikarikar with KLS BPP Civil Engineering Department colleagues. You can find technical lectures, laboratory experiments, and also field knowledge of civil engineering in this channel. It gives me immense pleasure to inform that our participants are from 30 different countries. They are US, UK, Australia, Thailand, Afghanistan, Ethiopia, Nepal, Pakistan, Qatar, Bangladesh, Sri Lanka, Hungary, Zimbabwe, Nigeria, Iraq, Somalia, Canada, Saudi Arabia, Morocco, Tanzania, UAE, Bhutan, Philippines, Kenya, China, Kuwait, Turkey, Namibia, Myanmar, and Uganda. Thank you for your active participation. Also, I would like to mention we had around 7,000 views for the first 4 webinar sessions. Thank you for the interest and support. To begin with our final session, I would like to introduce our resource person, Professor Lakshmi Angdi. Professor Lakshmi Angdi is born and brought up in Belgaum. She has completed her Bachelor's of Engineering in KLE Dr. M.S. Sheshgiri College of Engineering and Technology, Belgaum. Presently, she is working as lecturer in Department of Civil Engineering of KLS Shri Vasantra Poddar Polytechnic, Belgaum, from last 6 years. I welcome you, madam. Now, I hand over the platform to Professor Lakshmi Angdi.
A very warm good morning to all the viewers out there. Firstly, I would like to thank Swati Joshi madam for introducing me. Thank you, madam. So, the topics for today's session is the solid waste management. So, I think we all are aware about such a scenario in and around our surrounding, in our country, in our town, and everywhere where we live. It is a result of the development, the industrialization, the growing population, and the greed of the human being to achieve more, to become more advanced, to become more powerful. Along with this, we have one more byproduct, that is the waste that is generated during this process. It's almost like buy one, get one free. Along with the development, at the same time, we are generating a huge amount of waste across the world. The scenario is the same. Let it be a developed country or a developing country. The scenario remains the same, but it's not much spoken about. Now, what is a waste? Something that is no longer useful, something that is unwanted, the things that are going into the dustbins that needs to be discarded is called as the waste. And all this waste is nothing but it's the byproduct of the human activities. It is not something that the nature is creating. It is something that we are creating into our day-to-day life. It is estimated that the world generates around 2.01 billion tons of municipal solid waste annually. 2.01 billion tons. And here it is mentioned, it is just the municipal waste that is generated. And the World Bank Organization has estimated that by 2050, the world is expected to generate around 3.4 billion tons of municipal solid waste annually. 3.4 billion tons. And this is just the municipal waste, I'm stressing, because there are again different types of waste, but this is just an account that is considered for the municipal solid waste that is going to be generated. You can just imagine it's going to be such a huge amount of waste that is going to be generated all across the world. It's almost like a what a waste. Therefore, it becomes very important step for each one of us to manage such a waste. Then comes into action the solid waste management. Now, what is this solid waste management? Solid waste management is nothing but it is the process that includes the activities and the actions required to manage the waste from its inception to its disposal. So we can term it as the entire procedure or the process or the methodology, whatever we are going to use and the actions that we are going to take to dispose of the waste from its generation point to the disposal site. The entire process or the entire procedure collectively can be termed as the solid waste management. Next, why it is important for us to understand the solid waste management? Why nowadays we can hear in everywhere green city, sustainability? Why is it of uttermost important? Why so much of weightage is given for such a new concept? Therefore, we have already seen that there is so much amount of waste that we are generating. And in the coming years, it's not going to reduce. But obviously, with the developments, the increase in the population, it is going to grow larger and larger. And at the same time, it's very important for us to protect the environment. The environment does not belong to any particular creed. It is a home to hundreds of living organisms. Therefore, it's our duty to protect the environment. At the same time, also protect the health of the public, to maintain the hygienic conditions. None of us would like to stay in an unhygienic conditions. We can just imagine if the solid waste is just thrown on the streets where we dwell or where we stay. After a few days, it starts getting decomposed. It starts getting stinks. Foul smell comes out of it. Would we like to stay in such a condition? No. Also, it creates a home to the flies, the mosquitoes, which become the carrier of the disease. And for sure, we can see another explosion of a pandemic similar to corona if the steps are not taken at the right time. Next, let us see what all does a solid waste include. The solid waste mainly consists of, first type is the municipal solid waste, generally known as the MSW waste. It is locally termed as a garbage or as a trash. It consists of everyday waste that is generated from the homes, from the commercial outlets, from the hotels. It may be solid or semi-solid in nature. And this contributes to a very large amount of the solid waste. And whatever is the waste that is coming from the home, that is the vegetable peelings, the fruits, the thrown out dust, the sweep dusting, and might be the remains, the stale food and used items, used cartons, etc. These all contribute to the municipal solid waste. Next is the medical waste. Medical waste is defined as the disposal of any human infectious agent or the equipment that is capable of transmitting disease to the humans. So, in general terms, what we can say is whatever is the waste that is generated from the hospitals or the medical institutes, we can term it as a medical waste. Next, coming to the industrial waste. The waste that is generated from the industries is called as an industrial waste. Now, what type of waste is generated from the industry? It again depends upon the manufacturing process. Which type of a product is being manufactured in that particular industry, and there are every possibility that this type of waste can be hazardous in nature. Next, we come to the agricultural waste. Agricultural waste is nothing but the waste that is generated during the agricultural activities. This includes herbicides, the remains of the crops, the plastics, the silage, the milk house, and the milk house waste, rather the cow dung. And more than 90% of the agricultural waste that is produced is biodegradable and recyclable. So apart from this, the solid waste also includes the discarded appliance that is termed as e-waste, the furnitures, the automobile waste, the street sweepings, the construction and demolition waste, that is the C&D waste, the dead animals, hazardous waste from the industries as discussed previously, the sludge from the industry, waste water treatment plants, etc. So the entire procedure of the solid waste management is classified into 5 stages. The first one is the waste storage. The second one is the collection. Then comes the transportation, processing, and the final disposal. So whatever way we are planning, whichever methodology we are going to opt, we should see to it, it is the most economical, that is lower in cost, and is the most environmentally friendly. So, coming to the first one, that is the storage. The storage of the waste can be carried out in the cans, in the bags, or in the bins. Now, whichever type of container that we are going to use, it should be fly tight, airtight, rotten proof container with a secured lid. And it is advisable that at this stage only we segregate out the organic waste and the inorganic waste. I would also suggest that we can go for different colored dust bins so that we can separate out the recyclable waste, that is the paper, the metal, the glass, and the wood from the non-recyclable materials. So at the later stage, the processing becomes easy and proves to be economical. As in the previous session, Mr. Santosh Kulkarni sir spoke about the IoT applications in the civil engineering. We can somehow go for the smart dustbins. That is, The dustbins can be fixed with the sensors. So once the capacity or the garbage that is collected in the dustbin exceeds a certain limit, the sensor should get activated and the message should be sent to the worker for cleaning of the bins. So with this type, we can maintain a clean and hygienic environment, especially at the public places. So the next method is the, or the next step is the collection. Briefly, the collection can be done in two ways. First one is the self-collection. Second one is the curbside pickup. Now, in the self-collection, for a particular area, a point is fixed wherein the individual or the residents of that particular area need to go and drop their garbage at that particular point. The next one is the curbside pickup, which is the most common and largely used in every country. This is nothing but the home-to-home pickup that is carried out. A person or a worker is appointed for the daily pickup. The frequency of the collection also might vary. It might be done daily, once per week, twice per week, or might be on demand and might be less frequent for the recyclable materials. I would suggest a daily pickup would be better because the garbage that is collected is fresh and it will not stale or stink. Here, we can go for the RFID system, that is the radio frequency identification devices, which can be fixed for the pickup vehicles as well as the individual homes to check whether there is the daily pickup that has been done for the garbage. So these are the vehicles which are being used to transport the garbage. Even these vehicles have come up with the smart features in them. They are having a feature to compress the sewage or the waste that is collected so as to increase the capacity in the vehicle, and a large amount of garbage can be transported at a single stretch. So with this will be lesser fuel is consumed to transport a very large amount of garbage. The next step is the transportation. Transportation or transferring is nothing but transporting the collected garbage from the point of its collection to the point of its disposal. If the distance between the collection and the disposal site is too large, then an intermediate transfer station is appointed. The collected garbage is transferred to the transfer station and from there by trains or tankers or trucks or any other mode of vehicles can be used for the long distance transporting. Care should be taken to see that there is no accidental leakage that takes place during the transportation. It's usually preferred to opt for a covered vehicle so that during the transportation, the garbage will not be falling on the roads and creating an unhygienic condition or creating the nuisance. At this stage, we can opt for the GPS trackers. So the GPS tracker system can be employed in every truck, whichever is carrying the garbage. And this also will help us to opt for the smallest available route. This is termed as route optimization in transferring of the garbage. These all steps will further help us to prove the economically well-sound method. So next is the most important step, that is the processing. Processing is nothing but it is the methodology that we are going to adopt to reduce the waste to its smallest possible volume. Now, whichever methodology we are going to adopt, it should have the following objectives. Firstly, volume reduction, the size reduction, the component separation, and the resource recovery. The volume reduction and the size reduction can be carried out by shredding, incineration, and by grinding. The component separation can be done by hand sorting, screening, magnetic separation, and by air classifications. So, as I mentioned, if the sorting has been done at the primary stage, that is during the collection, if we segregate out the decomposable waste with the non-degradable waste and the recyclable waste can be segregated out separately, at this stage it becomes very easy for us for the further processing. Next, whatever is the waste that is being generated before the disposal, we should recover the energy that is present in that particular waste. This is very important for the sustainable development of the environment. The waste processing, I have just chosen the three methods, that is recycling, composting, and by incineration. So, what is recycling? Recycling is nothing but the process that allows us to reuse the material. It is nothing but it allows the valuable raw materials such as paper, glass, aluminium, and iron to be recovered from the waste and it can be reused. The benefits includes we are reducing the volume of the waste that is getting generated, we are conserving the raw materials, and hence the impact on the environment that is going to be created, it is reduced. For all this thing, public education and responsible policies have become the key element for the success. How we are going to implement this into the society is a very important challenge for each one of us. So here are few of the recyclable waste: the steel, the tin cans that we use at our homes, the aluminium cans, the glass bottles, the plastics, the cartons. For this we can also include the used cloths, the torn out cloths, the wood, the papers, etc. So next, I have an eminent personality, or rather he can be called as an emperor of the paper industry, Mr. Rajan Aduwalia. Born and brought up in Mumbai, India. In 1979, graduated from the University of Mumbai with the Bachelor of Science in Organic Chemistry. He was passionate about the green environment and recycling from his childhood. In 2006, he went to Canada to pursue his passion for the cleaner and a greener earth. He has developed one of a perfect secret to manufacture the office style paper from 100% waste paper and worn out cloths. And it's really amazing to note that the paper is recycled many more times than it can be. What does this mean? Usually, the paper can be recycled for maximum 7 to 8 times. This is the maximum limit the paper can be recycled. But he is having a secret methodology or a secret technique which helps us to recycle the paper more than its lifetime. And this method uses non-toxic chemicals and creates no harmful byproducts and produces a stronger paper than the normal one. So it's very important for us to stress here, whichever secret methodology he is using, it does not produce any harm to the environment. A very significant and a notable contribution to the nature, I feel. He has not limited himself just for the recycling of the paper, but also he is done with the glass recycling. He converts the glass into an interlocking bricks. And these bricks are coated with titanium oxide. We have to note that these bricks have an unique property of air cleaning. So I think he becomes an inspiration to many of us, and his ideas are really worth notable. So, next method is the composting. Now, what is composting? It is nothing but, it is a natural process that reduces the volume of the organic waste while producing a natural fertilizer. It's nothing but, it's a biological decomposition of the organic waste. By the help of the bacteria, by the help of the worms, or might be any other organism under the controlled aerobic condition. And the end product that we are going to gain is the natural fertilizer in the form of the humans. It is a 100% environmentally friendly and a safe management approach when compared to all other methods. Now, we all are aware about the organic farming. What is exactly the organic farming? The natural fertilizer that is opted from the organic decomposition that is used in the organic farming. We all want to buy organic vegetable, organic fruits, up to the limit of organic jaggery also. So, we can follow this composting to reduce whatever organic waste has been generated into the city and manufacture the fertilizer. In turn, this can be used for the farming, and hence it's a 100% environmental sustainable method. This is the somehow the humus that has been created looks like this. So I have a one more eminent personality to introduce here, that is C. Srinivasan, the project director at Indian Green Service Technology India. He is an expert in a zero waste management. He is quite famous for the SLRM model, that is the solid and liquid resource management model, or also known as the Vellore model. Now, according to us, whatever we are going to throw into a dustbin is a waste. That is our mentality. But he believes that whatever goes into the dustbin, especially the organic waste that we are going to throw in the dustbin, within 12 hours of time, it is not a waste, but it becomes a raw material for some use. He usually collects the waste, especially the organic waste, twice a day in the Vellore city, that is within the 12 hour span, and it is used for feeding of the dry cattles. I would like to stress here, dry cattles. Therefore, the cow dung obtained in this process from these dry cattles, it is utilized for the vermicast production and also in the biogas production. Therefore, 50% of the organic waste that is collected in the city or the town of Vellore is being utilized for cattle feeding. The remaining is sent to an eco-friendly composting beds to convert it into the fertilizers. What is this eco-friendly composting bed? In the process of composting, we all are aware the degradation of the materials begin. Hence, there are mosquitoes and flies that start dwelling in that particular area. And foul smell starts coming and it becomes a bit problematic to maintain the environment. Now, in the eco-friendly composting bed, he uses the fish tank. The bed is set up in between the fish tank so that whatever are the mosquitoes or the flies that are being generated during the composting process, the fish feed on them and hence a hygienic condition is maintained. Next, we have the incineration method. So, in this incineration, the use of high temperature combustion is carried out to burn the waste and to reduce it into the mineral ash residue. It is, you can say it is a very good method, but it is having its own drawbacks. Although we are converting the large amount of waste into ash, but then the disposal of this ash becomes a problem. As well as during this process, many chemical gases are being ejected out, which again become a very big concern for us. But at the same time, if this basic concept we are going to use it in different manner to regain the energy, then I think this would be sustainable method. So, in the incineration, whatever is the heat that we are going to recover can be used to run the turbines to for the generation of the electricity or for the water heating in the industries. Here I would like to quote that the Confederation of European Waste to Energy Plants uses 50 million tons of the solid waste to generate energy, which is used to supply the electricity. So around 17 to 18% of the European electricity is generated by this particular process. So next, coming to the cement industry, we all are aware it is one of the fastest growing industry. It is advancing greatly in last few decades. The development is not going to start. The consumption of cement is not going to stop. But at the same time, we need with an alternate fuel. The replacement of the conventional fuel can be carried out with the waste materials such as mixture of non-recycled plastics, papers, the used tire, the biomass waste, the RDF, that is the refuse derived waste, and the municipal solid waste. So at the same time, what we are doing, we are preserving the fossil fuels and also we are disposing of the waste in a much more useful way. Next method is the plastic plasma pyrolysis method. We all are aware plastic is one of the most harmful and the toxic material that we are using. It is cancerous in nature and is non-biodegradable. It takes around 300 years or more, depending upon the size, for it to decompose. Therefore, plasma pyrolysis provides solution for complete pyrolysis of the typical plastic, rubber, or the glass waste. It is one such technology that can dispose of all the kinds of waste almost without generating a polluting toxic chemicals. is a schematic diagram representing the plasma process. Firstly, the waste is put into the feeder and it is reduced to the smallest size possible. Next, it is transferred to the secondary chamber. A transformer supplies necessary voltage to the graphite fixed inside the chamber, as a result of which a very high temperature over 3000 degrees Celsius is generated. This results in the production of the syngas, which is then passed through the water scrubber. Therefore, further this gas can be used for the power production. One of the very good method, but not implemented largely because of the high initial cost and the maintenance cost. And also we need to create a very high temperature in this process. So the next process is encapsulating waste. Now what is encapsulation? Capturing something inside is called, in a general term rather, capturing something inside, we can term it as encapsulating. It's one of the most suitable method for disposing of the nuclear waste or any of the hazardous chemicals that are present. Encapsulation is a waste disposal method that packs hazardous material into the container made of impervious and non-reactive material, and the container are sealed with the concrete or a steel. Then these containers are buried deep inside the ground so as they don't have any side effects or ill effects into the surrounding environment. So next we come to the solid waste disposal, the final stage in the solid waste management. As far as possible, we should try to recycle and reuse. When there is no possibility, then the end product has to be disposed of. I have taken up the three methods of disposal, that is the dump site, the sanitary landfills, and the bioreactor sandfill. So the dump site is one of the old primitive method, but not recommended for the use. In dump sites, the garbage that is collected from the from the households or from the cities, from the towns, it is collected and carried to the outskirts of the city or the town to an open land, and the garbage is just dumped into the open land without any proper procedure. Therefore, with this, it has many problems that it is going to create. Firstly, there are chances of fire explosion, which might catch to the surrounding forest or the residence. Next, it releases toxic gases, which is inhaled by the public staying in and around that particular place, which might lead to health issues for them. Very harmful for the children staying in and around that particular place. The mosquitoes and the flies start dwelling there. They become the carrier of many of the diseases. In long run, it is going to contaminate the groundwater table, and also it is going to contaminate the streams and the rivers and the lakes which are there nearby. It also causes soil pollution. The soil loses its fertility in that particular area. It causes damage to the lands and the wildlife habitat in that particular area. And altogether, it creates an unhygienic condition for the local community. So this particular process is least preferred. Next is the sanitary landfill, a advanced version of the dump site, we can say, wherein the problems that arise in the open dumps are taken care to certain extent. So, in the sanitary landfills, an engineered process is employed in disposing of the solid waste. The waste is reduced to the smallest particle volume and then it is compacted into a low-lying areas and it is covered at the end of each day with a covering material, which is usually a soil. So this is a small animation with which I would like to explain the landfill. So a low-lying or a trench is being excavated if the low-lying area is not available. So the daily collected waste is compressed in its volume as much as possible, then dumped. Then a covering layer, usually the soil or might be any alternative material, can be used. And this procedure is continued till the final cover. Although little, we are taking care of the few of the drawbacks of the open dumps, but at the same time, it is again utilizing the lands. With the increasing population, we can't opt for such a method because we don't have place for the public, for the residents. Also, in long run, it is going to emit off the gases which is not in under our control. Therefore, this results into air pollution. And also, the soil that is present in that particular area gets contaminated. And in long run, again, the groundwater also gets polluted. Next, the last one is the bioreactor landfills. The bioreactor landfill is one of the biological decomposition method. It accelerates the biological decomposition of the waste in the landfills by promoting conditions necessary for microorganisms. So in the previous two methods, there were no controlled conditions or there was no proper planning to accelerate the decomposing process. In this method, the controlled addition and removal of the moisture from the waste, through this, we increase the biological activity and hence the decomposition takes place at a faster rate. So you can see the leachate nitrification is being used to maintain the moisture in the landfill and hence the decomposition is under the control. And the gases that are emitted are also captured and they can be used for the energy generation. This is one of the most sustainable methods in the treatment. The advantages is the active degradation is possible, rather like in the previous method, decomposing it slowly. The leachates are circulated and hence the moisture required is maintained. The gases can be trapped and can be used for another generation of electricity or any other purpose. So here we come with the solid waste hierarchy, to the most desirable option to the least desirable option. Rather, we can say these are the five principles in the solid waste management. The first and foremost is to reduce. As much as possible, each and every one of us can minimize the amount of waste that we are producing. Next is reuse. Reuse the material before you send them for recycling. The pages that are remaining in your notebooks, take them, combine them and bind it and use it for the rough work. Through this, we are reducing the amount of paper that is going for recycling. Hence, reuse should be the most implemented into day-to-day life. Next is recycle and preserve the mineral ores or the natural resources as far as possible. Opt for the natural composting methodologies for decomposing the organic material. Next, recover. Before disposal of any waste, even after recycling, composting, whatever is the residue that is remaining, before disposal, recover the energy and use this energy, transmit it into any useful form and use this energy. The last and the least desirable option would be the disposal. And when we are going for the disposal, we should see to it, we opt for the safest disposal method so as to not create an environmental hazard. Next, let us see some of the business models in the solid waste management. There are many people, many entrepreneurs or the business tycoons who are converting waste into gold. The best examples were Mr. Rajan Ahluwalia and Sri Srinivasan. There are many other notable people. I have just quoted two examples here. Firstly, from the wet waste, we can go for the biogas plants. Therefore, the heat that has been generated in these biogas plants can be used for cooking, heating water, or for any other industrial purpose. Then, also, the organic waste can be composed, and through the composting procedure, we get the natural fertilizers which can be used for the organic farming. Recyclable waste should be recycled using the new technology. Reuse the materials, plastic, clothes, paper, glass, wood, as far as possible, recycle them using the new technology, reuse them so that we reduce the burden on the Mother Earth. Here, one more contribution, that is the construction and the demolition waste. We all are aware how much large amount of construction and demolition waste is generated all across the world. Now, disposing this waste is also one of the concern. Therefore, it is recommended to use this particular waste combined with the fly ash and certain amount of cement to prepare the bricks. And these bricks replace the conventional bricks through which again we are preserving the earth that are used in manufacturing of the conventional bricks. And also, these bricks can be used for the construction wherein the structure or the member of that particular structure is not taking much load, such as the partition walls, the compound walls, etc. Also, the construction and demolition waste can be used in the manufacturing of the paver tiles. Therefore, through this we can make an 100% utilization of the construction waste. Next, what are the factors that are going to affect the solid waste management? So, whatever is the approach that we are going to take, it again depends upon the country where we do stay. How much is the per capita income? What is the status of that particular country? Whether it is a developed country, developing country? What is the climatic conditions of that particular country? The systematic growth of the cities, the growth of the population, the count of the population, the lifestyle of the people in that particular country, the status of the municipalities, the authorities that the municipalities are given, the authorities or the powers which they possess, and the resources that are available, the technology that is available. So, all these factors do contribute to the solid waste management. Therefore, I would conclude saying that reduce, reuse and recycle. It's reuse, reduce, recycle. I would rather say first we have to reduce as much as waste that is going to be generated, reuse as much as possible and recycle the waste. Therefore, It's time to take into consideration the environmental degradation that is occurring due to the amount of waste that we are generating. Every country should have a visionary to implement zero waste production, or the zero waste management rather. It becomes the responsibility of each and every one of us to take care of the surrounding where we live in, because the nature, the Mother Earth, belongs to each one of us, and it's not with just our generation. This nature needs to be handed over to the coming next generation. And also we need to take care of the hazards that we are creating in our own nature. Therefore, go in hand with the nature will take care of itself. If we go against the rule, it knows how to manage itself. Thank you. I would like to thank all the viewers for the patient listening. I also thank Abhijit sir, HOD of Civil Department, for giving me the platform. I also thank Principal Mrs. S.S. Malaj ma'am and the KLS management. Thank you. The questions are: okay, the first question is from Anwar Hulak. Sorry if I have pronounced it wrong. Would it be appropriate to make the garbage enter inside the residential area to manage the daily collection of the garbage, or it must be out of the city? So I would rather suggest that it is not appropriate to make the garbage disposal enter inside. Obviously, it is going to create an unhygienic conditions here if you are going to dispose of the garbage within the city. And also, more amount of land is required, and the people residing in that particular area would be at a very high risk, as we have discussed. So the next question is from Priya Mithal. Can you please relate solid waste management with EIA? So, Priya, I think it's all completely related to each other. Through the solid waste management, obviously, we can reduce or avoid the impact of the waste on the environment and also allow for the proper ecology. Reduce the impact on the environment, and hence these both are closely related to each other. Next is Dhruv Yadav. Solid waste can be used in construction work or not? Yes. As we have already discussed, and I think in the previous session also, Mr. Abhijit sir also had just preferred something related to this. And as I said, the demolished waste can be used for the construction of the bricks and also for the construction of the pavers. And largely, we can see that there is a replacement of fly ash into the concrete, the plastic into the concrete. So all these things, one or the other way, we are using or trying to use or trying to build a sustainable concrete. Through this, we are using the solid waste into the concrete. I thank all the viewers once again. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Lakshmi Angdi, for the wonderful session. There were really good points to be noted. I would like to thank our resource persons, Professor Abhijit Baikarikar, Professor T. Veena, Professor S. S. Malaj, Professor Santosh Kulkarni, and Professor Lakshmi Angdi for sharing their knowledge with us. I would like to thank all the participants for actively participating in the webinar series. I thank our management, Karnataka Law Society, our chairman, Sri UN Kalkundrikar, our principal, Professor S.S. Malaj, for giving us opportunity to conduct this international webinar series in civil engineering. I thank our HOD, Professor Abhijit Baikrikar, and also founder of All About Structural Analysis and Design, for providing us this platform to conduct the webinar series. It was his idea to start a national level webinar, which turned out to be an international level webinar with participants from 30 countries. Thank you, sir. This event wouldn't be possible without the hard work of each and every staff of Civil Engineering Department. I thank Seema Madam, Pradeep Sir, Lakshmi Madam, Patil Sir and Swarupa Ma'am for your support and preparation from day one in making this international webinar series a grand success. Thank you, one and all. I request all the participants to submit the questionnaire and feedback form which has been provided in the description of video and also has been mailed to the participants. The e-certificate will be issued to the participants within 30 days. Thank you, have a nice day and a safe year.